Hey everyone, welcome to the Stories of Language Learners. I'm your host, Charles. Today's guest is actor, singer, and ESL instructor Samuel Araújo from Brazil. Our episode today is gonna be a little bit different. I decided to split it in part 1 and part 2 because I didn't wanna make this episode too long. So, in part 1, Samuel and I talk about how Samuel was able to learn English with no money, building projects to improve English, why you should have a goal to learn a new language, using every opportunity to get better at English, why we need to commit mistakes in the process of learning, going to exchange fairs in the university to practice English, which method Samuel uses to teach English. I had an amazing time talking with Samuel. I really enjoyed our conversation, and I'm sure that you guys are going to enjoy it as well. Hey everyone, welcome to the Stories of Language Learners. Today I'm so excited to have Samuel on the show. Hello Samuel, thank you so much for being here. How are you?
Hey, thank you so much for having me here. I'm pretty good. How about you?
Yeah, I'm really great. And yeah, so before we get started, could you please introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. My name is Samuel Araújo. I am an actor, professional actor and singer, and I'm also an ESL teacher for about 5 years. And I'm from Rio de Janeiro, and I have been teaching English for 5 years, as I said, and I'm very passionate about how English learning can transform people's lives in other areas that are not related to education necessarily. And this is something I always say when I'm introducing myself, because this is part of me and part of the transformation I want to cause in the world.
Yeah, some of the things that I always talk about in the podcast, it's like when you are learning this language, which is the global language, it is kind of a new door is open, a door with so many new opportunities that you wouldn't have if you didn't learn this language, right? So we were talking about how we met, because this is a really curious and interesting story, and I said to Samuel, let's wait a little bit because I think that people should hear about how we ended up here today recording this episode. So basically I found Samuel through Instagram 5 years ago because I saw that he was participating in a movie, and which we're gonna talk about later about his movie. But yeah, I basically found him on Instagram, and I remember that one day he was asking for people, oh, are you struggling with English? Do you want some tips or any advice? So I am asking for people, for them to send me email. So feel free to send me email so we can chat and I can try to help you. And this was 5 years ago. I started learning English in 2015, so it was in the beginning of my learning journey. And I talked about in this podcast because I suffered a lot and I thought that I wouldn't be able to speak in this language because I thought it was too hard. And yeah, basically we ended up exchanging some emails. Last night I was reading these emails and I was talking about it with Samuel, and I can't believe that he replied my message, because my emails was like a huge book. It was so long, and he was so kind to reply my emails, and he gave me a lot of tips and suggestions about how to improve. I think we exchanged more than 5 emails. Okay, so fast forward to 2019. Last year, I started to use LinkedIn, and all of a sudden, I saw Samuel in there, and then I added him as a friend on LinkedIn. And okay, so nowadays, I think 2 weeks ago, I was scrolling through my LinkedIn feed and I saw a post from Samuel, and I saw his position where was written ESL teacher. And I thought, oh, he's an English teacher. I think that I will try to invite Samuel. I have no idea if he will say yes or not, but I will try. And he kindly agreed to be here today. So yeah, thank you again for being here. Okay, so let's get back to you. This is basically the whole story. When did you start learning English?
Well, first, I gotta say that I got emotional with this introduction because I do remember we exchanged emails, but I don't remember what I asked you guys to do to send me an email because that was 5 years ago. And that's so great, really. That gets me very emotional. Thank you so much, Thales. And to answer your question, I'm going to give you probably a long answer because my history and my background with English is pretty long and interesting. So I have always loved learning English and speaking English because as an actor and as someone who has always wanted to be an actor, I would always watch the Oscar nomination and say, okay, I'm going to do the interview in English. But I grew up in a very poor house. My family didn't have any money to pay for course, to pay for the bus ticket for me to go to any course. So I literally did not have any resources to be able to study English. So my first resource was a grammar book, English grammar book, that someone from church didn't want anymore. And they just told me, hey, do you want this? They didn't want the book anymore. They weren't doing this for charity. They were just doing this because they didn't want it anymore. And I have always known my way around learning something I really want. And I started reading the book and I started watching TV, not my TV because I didn't have a TV. My cousin had a TV. And I would always go to her house to watch the TV and to read the book and to learn the grammar. That's how I started. And because of this book, I learned a lot, but I was learning by myself. So I remember that this was when I was 12. I only got the opportunity to definitely start studying in a public course when I was 14. And then I studied for 3 years there, but I already knew a lot of English because of the grammar book. And because of that, they would promote me to a monitor position in the public course. And that experience of helping people made me realize, okay, I think I'm pretty good at it, and I think I can help others. But life got in the way, and I had to study for college to be able to get a full scholarship or to pass in the exam to study in a federal university. So I just stopped practicing and learning English. And I remember that I just got into college in 2012, and then I started an internship in the international news agency in 2014, 2 years later. And when I started there, they didn't require me to speak English, but that was one of the three most important international news agencies in the world. And I saw the need to speak English, but I couldn't. So guess what I did? I had a phone, which was my professional phone, that I could call anyone in the world because this agency had a branch in each country, in every country in the world. So when you want to make a foreign call, you just have to press some buttons and you get to make the call in a low cost. So what I would always do is to call people from the USA to practice English.
That's awesome.
But I didn't know how to speak very well. So because I forgot everything. And I remember I would always make a mistake that people would laugh at me. Like, I remember one day I was calling an institution and I was just calling to talk, to practice. And then the guy said that he would send me an email, but he didn't. And then I called the other day, hey man, so I think you didn't send an email. I didn't get your email. And then he said, okay, so can you please spell your email address? And I would say, okay, I'm gonna do it right now. And I started spelling it. And then when I tried to spell arroba, and I said arroba, and then the guy started laughing on the phone. And then he said, okay. And he started speaking Portuguese. He was Brazilian. And then I said, okay, X. And then he corrected me, X. And I said, man, why did you not speak Portuguese with me yesterday? And then he said, because you were so good. I didn't see the need to speak Portuguese. I didn't know a lot at that time. I was still trying to get my way back to English. And that's interesting because at that time, I didn't have any money at all. I was doing internship, but I also had the college and I had a lot of responsibilities at home. So what I would always do is, okay, I know English, but I can't build sentences. So I have to make a way to get everything here out. So I would always go to exchange fairs here in Rio, where you have a lot of American universities, Australian universities, to talk to them. And then I would always prepare a list with my questions and my answers so I could get confident to be able to speak more. Because my first experience going to the fair was like looking at the person, talking to me, understanding nothing, and just getting scared and go away. My first experience, I thought, oh man, I have to plan this out. I gotta do this. I cannot give up. That was so freaking out experience because I remember me going to many exchange fairs, all of them in Rio, just to practice English. And I would always have my list with the questions and with my answers, so I would know how to speak. And my university, I graduated from Federal University, UFRJ, here in Rio. And the federal universities have a program which is called English Without Borders, where you can enroll in a course for 3 months or 1 month. It's for free and it's really good. And they were offering a pronunciation course for 1 month, and that was for free, but that was on Saturday. And I said, okay, I'm going to do it. I know I can't speak it, but I'm going to do it. And then I did it. Man, that was crazy because the course was focused on pronunciation, but we had to speak English. And I had to speak. And I remember that I would always write something with a lot of grammar mistakes. And the teacher would always correct me. And I thought like, oh my God, this is very embarrassing. Because at that time, what I always got was constructive feedback. Nobody ever would always say to me, hey, you did this really good. Because I wasn't good. I was learning again. And when you are learning English, it's very frustrating at the beginning because you really want to communicate. And sometimes it just doesn't work out. And you have to still keep trying. And I didn't have any money to go for private classes. I didn't have any money to hire a teacher. I didn't have any money to pay for a course. I didn't have any money to talk to other people, to go to touristic places, to be able to talk to someone. I was really broke financially. I didn't have any money at all. So when I share my experience, I think I can help people because I am in that place where you don't have any resources. So mm-hmm. I would always use the phone from a work, which was something that was turned out to be really good. I enrolled in this course, 1 month pronunciation course. And then some months later, I enrolled in a 3 months English course focused on writing and speaking. And I remember that in between all these courses, which was 2 courses, 1 month and 3 months, I would always go to the fairs, practice on the phone in my internship and watch series on YouTube. Or I didn't have Netflix at that time. So I would always go to YouTube, which is free, to watch and to practice. And I remember that year, like 2014, a very difficult time for me because I wanted to become fluent and I didn't have the resource. I did have some resources, but I was my English was very rusty. And the crazy thing about that is I started this in April 2014, right? I started my way back to English. And then 1 year later, I became an English teacher. So in 1 year, I was able to come from nothing with English to an English teacher. And why? Because I took advantage of all the resources I had available and I was very persistent. I really wanted to be better. And I remember making mistakes all the time. That's only what I felt. I'm making mistakes all the time. I only felt the mistakes. I think that's how you feel at the beginning, you know? So just to sum up the conversation, it's I did learn this between 2007 and 2010, but then I stopped studying, so I didn't have any practice anymore. And I went back to learn English in 2014, and then in 2015, I became a teacher.
Awesome. That's so amazing. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And it's so inspiring because sometimes people think that it's too hard. But nowadays, I mean, for example, nowadays, we have so much resource. We have no excuse to learn any language because we have the internet, which is a powerful tool. And your story, it's really incredible because you had zero resource, but you did have a lot of desire of learning. And you said to yourself, I will use anything that I can use that is available for me in my situation, and I will learn, and I will get there. And today, you are an English teacher. This is awesome. And this, while you were talking, I was... Your conversation reminds me and brought to my memory a story. I had a colleague in my last job, and she would always say to me the story of her... I don't remember exactly who this person was, but basically it was someone from her family. It was a guy that when he was a kid, he would always say to everyone, one day I will learn another language and I will travel and I will go out, I will live abroad. And she said to me that this guy, he was really poor, but every event, every opportunity where people would get together to speak in English, free events or things like that, this guy would be there always. And fast forward to today, this guy, he lives in Ireland, and he was the first Brazilian guy who has an English school in Ireland. And he had to, I don't know how to say, but basically it wasn't legal, for example, for a Brazilian person to have a company in there at that time. I don't know, it was 5 or 10 years ago. But this guy, he fought for it, and today he has this English school in Ireland. He was the first Brazilian to have this English school in Ireland. So yeah, so you don't have to have a lot of resources. You just need to have the desire and the passion and use everything that you can use to reach your goal. It's not impossible. Nowadays you are an English teacher, so I would like to know a little bit, which English learning method do you like to use to teach your students?
As of today, I work for a company, for a very big school in Brazil. In this school, we use the communicative approach, which is something I really like. I feel really comfortable teaching in this method because it gives freedom for students to practice English freely, gives space for students to have their creativity on. So I do like the communicative approach. But I wouldn't say that teaching in schools the way they organize the content is my favorite way to teach English, because the way I have learned English is pretty different from this. But I was, of course, in another setting, so which made my experience different. So when I think about the method I use, because I do have private classes and I do have private students, it's called, it doesn't have a name actually, but it's usually focused on a very clear objective that students have. So for example, I have students who like games. So I would always play a game with them to help them learn English through the activity or through playing the game. But I also have students, for example, my sister, she loves articles, academic articles. So I would always help her learn English by using the articles. And it always depends on the students. But for example, this semester, I'm teaching two groups. And these two groups are students who don't have any money. I just started volunteering for these two groups. And one group is a group of students who need English for interview, and another group is for people who want to study abroad. And the methodology I use there, I would say it's a mix of communicative approach with project-based teaching, where you give a project that students have to build, and they have to build it in English. And this is probably something meaningful for them. But why do I say this is not fully communicative approach? Because the communicative approach has its main purpose in having students discussing situations in English, but it doesn't necessarily include projects or external projects, which is something I'm passionate about. I love projects. I love constructing, building something that makes sense for the students. And for the students being able to do that, they have to use English. So when I always teach English, I try to make English as a mean to a bigger purpose for them. It's a mix of communicative approach with project-based learning.
Great, thank you for sharing. So a couple of things. I think some of the things that you said that I think it's really interesting, and it's not the first time that I hear from other teachers. So I heard from, I think, more other two guests that I interviewed, and they were also English teachers, which is like find out what the students like. For example, you said, oh, my students like to play games, so I will try to make them learn through games. And I think this approach, it's really awesome and it's incredible, because I remember I had some experiences with traditional courses, but the reason why I dropped out these courses, it was because I wasn't motivated. It wasn't the kind of way that I enjoy learning. So this kind of approach, I think it's really great. People will enjoy doing what they like, so they will learn through doing it. Another thing that I think it's really incredible is that you also are doing some volunteer job. You're helping others. So kudos to you, for more people who give their time to help others. And one last thing that you said that I think it's really awesome, it's creating projects. And nowadays, I can say that I am a big fan of creating projects. So for example, if you have a problem, try to solve it by starting a new project. And I said this to you at the beginning of our, before we were recording, that I started this podcast because I wanted to connect, communicate with people, have fun, and improve my pronunciation. And here I am, recording season 2. And also, I'm learning web development, so I had to use my poor skills, but I am improving day by day. But I built a landing page for this podcast. Guys, create a project based on something that you enjoy. If you have something that you want to learn, a new skill, it's very powerful and it works.
Yeah, and the projects can be anything. For example, in these two groups, we have one project for each group. For example, for the group who is focused on preparing themselves for an interview, the project is, I'll be applying for two jobs in multinational companies, and I'm gonna prepare all my study as an application for these two companies. And when they do that, and when they do this together, you make them think about other jobs, other other careers, other people, and they also get feedback from other people in English about how to improve their CVs, how to apply for the other jobs. Maybe someone knows a job that's related to the other one's career. So that's why I think it's important for us to start projects that are meaningful to the students. Because let's be honest, nobody wants to learn English just because they love it. They want to be able to do something with it. And you gotta face it. You gotta use it.
Yeah, this is totally true. Yeah, I totally agree with you. Okay, let's move on to the next question. What are some of the biggest mistakes that you see people making when it comes to learning English?
Wow, that question is really good because I have this so clear in my mind. So the biggest mistake people make when they're trying to learn English is not having a very clear goal on why they want to learn English. And please don't tell me, oh, because I like it. This is not enough. Okay. So if you don't have a very clear, specific goal with why you need to speak and where you need to speak English, you will not be able to make it. Of course, you can improve a lot and you will, but it will take a long time to get there. So this is like a platform for another question that you ask, but I'm going to stop here. So it's basically this. If you don't have a very specific goal with it, you will take a long time learning it. And also, another mistake I see students making is being afraid to make mistakes. The thing is, you will always make mistakes. There is no way around this. There is no way where I'm here, I don't know the language, and I just skip all the mistakes and I'm fluent. That just doesn't make any sense for me and for anyone. So you gotta face the fact that you have to make mistakes. And the earlier you make the mistakes, the earlier you become better and the earlier you can communicate.
Yeah, so I can totally agree because at the beginning of my journey, I was so worried about not committing mistakes. But yeah, then I realized there's no other way. If I want to improve, for example, my speaking skills, I need to open my mouth and to start to speak. And admit that this is a process. It's not like, oh, I will start learning today and tomorrow we'll have a full conversation with someone for 1 hour. It's a process, it takes time, and yeah, it's okay to make mistakes. Okay, so the next question, do you learn English through music? I made this question because I saw a post on your Instagram where you were singing in German and you respond to me that you sing in a lot of languages. So what do you think?
Yeah, I do learn through music. So as a guy who was raised in church, I have learned how to sing since a very early age. So singing came before acting. So I'm very innerly connected to music. So for me, it's pretty simple. I don't know if you... Oh, that's something really good. Do you know that I do remember the first English song I've ever listened to in my entire life? And that song made me want to learn English. I can tell you the song right now. It's Because of You by Kelly Clarkson. Because I was listening to her. And when I listened to her singing, like, because of you, I'm flying straight. I don't remember the lyrics now. How is it? I wish... Oh my God, I don't remember now. Do you know the lyrics for this song?
I know the music, but I had no idea the lyrics.
I'm not straight too far from sidewalk. Because of you, I learned to play how to sit. I don't remember the lyrics now, but that was the first song ever I've listened to. When I listened to that song, I thought, okay, I can become fluent. I understand the lyrics. And I didn't know how to speak English at that time. That's the crazy thing about that. I could understand, but I didn't know many words. I hadn't started learning English at that time. And that's why music is so important to me. I started learning from music and I have done this until today. And in my English classes, if I see that someone really is into music, I will always have this person study a song with me. And we would always get the song that this person loves and we would always start studying the song together.
That's incredible. And I love to talk about music because I'm a music lover. I don't sing really well as you sing, but I remember that at the beginning of my journey, one of the first things that I started to do, it was like to immerse myself in the language. And the first thing that I did, it was starting to listen everything in English, a lot of songs. And I remember also when I was a kid, we would listen to some songs in the radio and I would wish so bad that I could understand the lyrics. It was like a dream and I would think, oh, maybe someday I would be able to sing as they sing, because the way that I'm trying to sing, I have no idea what is this, but it's not English. And yeah, I love to discuss about it, and you are not the first guest who said to me that I learned another language through music. Yeah. Okay, so let's move on because we have a few more questions here. Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed this episode. I hope you learned something. If you liked this podcast, please share it with your friends. I would love to hear your feedback about the show. Feel free to send me a message on Instagram. You can also join our global community on Telegram, and you can participate in our video calls to meet new people, make new friends, and practice your English while having fun. If you can't use Telegram, don't worry. Keep an eye on Instagram because I always make stories about our encounters. I will include links to all the resources that we mention in the show notes. And yeah, that's it. Thank you so much for listening, and I will see you in the next episode. Bye.